Ma lo le soifua maua malilangi mama, kore ke uhuwhanga te ngahi tala whakatapu ko oso no awhaki. Ko whainga maria koe ni, this very opportunity, I'm very fortunate to have Anaika, who is one of the authors of the recent Salvation Army State of the Nation 2021 report, which is titled Disturbed Present, Better Future, which points to serious, embedded and ongoing hardship for many in our communities. Ma loilele tālofa ana.
Malalele, John, thank you for having me.
Wonderful to have you on our Zoom chat. Now, the report found that Māori and Pasifika child poverty rates for 2019 are more than 50% higher than those for European children, and rates of material hardship are 2 to 3 times higher. Now, COVID-19 has only made existing inequities worse. What do you make of these dire findings, Anna?
Well, we are living in unprecedented times, and the report has shown that COVID-19 has cast a shadow over our nation, as we all are aware. I mean, continues to cast a shadow. We're still in level 3 lockdown here in Auckland. The report found that those that were living in hardship are the ones that have been impacted the most, and the findings that you talk about, John, is quite disheartening for Māori and Pasifika children, because we have the youngest population and the fastest growing youngest population in the country, and if you know that our young people are the future of New Zealand, and if they're living in poverty, and if they're living in material hardship, then that's quite discouraging for where the future, what the future holds for these for our Pasifika children, and particularly Pasifika, because on those government measurements on child poverty, Pasifika are the worst, with 28% of children living in material hardship are Pasifika children.
Yeah, so what do you think should be done, or what can we do now?
You know, the Salvation Army, we're a Christian organisation, and so we remain hopeful, even though a lot of these indicators are doom and gloom, that, you know, change will happen so that it benefits our Māori and Pasifika children. We're asking for courageous and bold policy moves from the government that's targeted particularly to those living in hardship, particularly to those who are vulnerable and the poorest in New Zealand, and that unfortunately includes our Māori and Pasifika families.
Yeah. Now let's talk about food security. In 2020, the Salvation Army distributed more than 110,000 food parcels. This is double the number in 2019. This is the highest number in the 14th year of this report. What do you make of this?
Food hardship is often the first indicator that families are struggling. And the numbers that we saw come through our food bank last year, and that are continuing this year, just as an indicator that people just don't have enough income to live on. I mean, if we look at the increasing living costs, we're looking at the rates of unemployment. These families, when they have to give up something, they often give up food. I mean, that's where the Salvation Army and other organisations and marais are coming in to be able to provide food for our families and our communities. It's disheartening, John, particularly when a lot of the people that are coming into the food banks that came in last year were actually donating to the food bank in 2019, and now they've found themselves in a position that they need to come to the food bank to get food for themselves.
Wow.
And so that's disheartening.
Yes. Now let's talk about some of the more daunting figures in the report, which includes social housing. The register has hit a record high at over 22,400 applicants in November. Nearly half of those on the register were Māori and 10% were Pasifika. Now you did mention earlier about the people that were requiring the service of the Salvation Army. Around 10,000 people used the Salvation Army services for the first time last year.
We saw a new face of hardship come through our doors. These are people, John, that have never accessed working income, that have never accessed a charity. And you can just imagine like the turmoil that they were in, that they had to come to a charity to be able to ask for food. But we encourage those who are still in hardship, that we're here to help, and our doors are open but it's particularly if you've never accessed welfare before, it's difficult. It takes a toll on your mental health and your well-being. But you know, we're here to support those who are struggling. And as you talked about social housing, I mean, Pasifika represent 10%. And that's not in 10%. That'll probably be around 2,200 people on the social housing register, Pasifika. But these are not 2,200 people. These are 2,200 families, John. And so, if you can just picture the, you know, the average size of a Pasifika family, we have quite big families. So you, it makes you wonder, like, where are these families now? They're probably in emergency or transitional housing. Or they're living in overcrowded housing. And so that's a concerning number when we put faces to the number that is on the social housing register. And the waiting time on the social housing register is also really long as well. So it's quite daunting. The report is quite daunting, John, but like I said before, we have to stay hopeful that, you know, that there will be change and that outcomes for our Pasifika people will improve.
Yeah. Now, speaking of trends for Pasifika and housing, education, poverty, vastly different, or is it the same compared to previous years? Like you did mention hope. Is there hope for our Pasifika community during this time?
We have to be hopeful, John. The hope is the difference between those who fall down and stay down and those who fall down and still try and get back up. And as a Christian organisation, we remain hopeful that that the government, that we work together with the government and have targeted policy, and that we work together with other community organisations to be able to support our Pasifika communities. But if when we're looking at the impact of COVID, hardship for Pasifika it got worse. It got worse, and it got worse for Māori as well. And it's those who there were cracks in society before COVID hit. Those cracks have just gotten bigger because of the shadow that COVID has cast. But, you know, again, I say we have to stay hopeful. We have to stay hopeful that the government will make courageous and bold policy moves so that, you know, our communities are moving out of hardship.
Now, this report is quite significant. There is a lot more information on Pasifika compared to previous years. For example, in 2019, this was the first year child poverty rates by ethnicity was reported. So it's not possible to assess progress over recent years. How crucial will it be to monitor changes for Pasifika in the years ahead?
Oh, it's crucial. As I said before, the Pasifika and Māori children, we represent like the fastest growing proportion of young people in this country. And the demographics of New Zealand will look different in the future because our young population is growing so fast. And so when we're looking to the future of New Zealand, we need to be able to track where our children and our young people are now at the moment. So the child poverty statistics that will come out next week by the government, it doesn't actually capture the impacts of COVID, but what we did identify in the report that there are 23,000 extra children now living in welfare dependent homes. This is not 23,000 children, it's 23,000 extra children from 2020 that are now in welfare dependent homes. And that's really concerning. So even though those stats aren't here, just by looking at the increase of numbers in welfare homes, it's not looking too promising for child poverty, but again, we need to stay.
Oh, I'm sorry, Anna, I think we just lost you for a minute there, but we did capture the last few words of what you just mentioned. Just to wrap things up. Now, Ronji Tanielu spoke on TVNZ's Breakfast this morning, and he said the challenge ahead lay not just with the government, but with local communities. He said, I quote, "We need to own some of the problems that are in our local communities. There are local solutions as well." So, Anna, what do you think Pasifika communities can do to address these inequalities?
You know, I think we can't blame the government for everything, John. As you know, as a Tongan from South Auckland, born and raised, not all the issues are to do with the government. And so, I think that's why we also need to take ownership. I mean, when we're looking at Pasifika, you know, one of the biggest support networks for Pasifika are our churches. And so, our churches and our families being able to support one another. To be able to move forward together. But I think, John, in COVID, we noticed that There was a huge issue with whakamā, or people were embarrassed to reach out to ask for help. And so we asked our Pacific, don't be too prideful, ask each other for help, ask your church for help. If churches are out there, offer, your congregants help, because a partnership with the government so that we could work together with local solutions as well, with national solutions as well.
Yeah, malo pito ana. And just to wrap things up, just remind us again, if there are families in need of help, can you give us some details how people can get in touch with your services?
Yeah, so the Salvation Army, we have many services. We have food bank, financial mentoring. If you just jump online and get the number of your local Salvation Army centre, and then you're able to call them, and then they'll give you a call. Our welfare team, we have a team of welfare experts that will call and see, see how you're doing, see what you need, and then they'll take the steps from there. We also have addiction services as well, and social work services. And so our welfare team will be able to put you on the services that you were needing.
Whaftai te re lava malo, o pito anaika from the Salvation Army.
Thank you, John.